Namaskar, good evening. You are watching Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Smriti Rastogi with News Tonight. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines. UPA government's 2014 budget figures were suspicious, says Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Reveals that white paper on the issue would have harmed the reputation of the Indian economy. Insists that opposition's unity moves are solely motivated by hatred against him. Rupee still overvalued by 5 to 7%, doesn't need intervention, says Niti Aayog Vice Chairman Rajiv Kumar. Asserts that reforms like GST will help India's growth at 8 to 9% in 2022. States and union territories told they can't appoint any police officer they please as acting DGPs. Supreme Court orders them to send list of probable candidates to UPSC for selection of three most suitable candidates. After over two decades, nearly 33,000 Bru community members to be repatriated from Tripura to Mizoram. Decision taken after tripartite agreement signed in the presence of Home Minister Rajnath Singh, Tripura Chief Minister Biplav Dev and Mizoram Chief Minister Lal Thanhawla. And over 1,500 Indian pilgrims stranded on the route to Kailash Mansarovar due to inclement weather. 308 people evacuated so far with Kathmandu's help on the Hilsa-Simikot route. Our top story, Niti Aayog Vice Chairman Rajiv Kumar on Tuesday said that the country's GDP growth will touch 8% next year. Addressing a press conference in Delhi, he described the Niti Aayog as neither a think tank nor a successor to the Planning Commission of the UPA era.
Niti Aayog Vice Chairman Rajiv Kumar on Tuesday asserted that the global economy has recovered from the trade crisis. Addressing the media, he exuded confidence that economic reforms like GST will help India grow at 8 to 9% in 2022, which currently has a growth rate of 7.5%.
I think because of all these reforms and all these measures that have been taken, we are now on the cusp of a major sustained and ongoing recovery. I think we will shift now from a 7.5% growth next year to 8 and 8 and above. And this is, I want to couple this with an announcement, which is that the Niti Aayog, it has been mandated to do so. We are coming out with the strategy for New India 2022. This has already been prepared and has been sent to the draft has been prepared and has now been sent to the chief ministers for their comments, which will be, of course, duly incorporated with all the attention. And
we'll also Kumar also noted that there has been ample employment generation in the past 4 years.
Debate based on sketchy and, you know, piecemeal data, I think, does nobody any good. Just to end by saying that I cannot emphasize more the fact that there has been ample employment generation in the last 4 years, as has been reflected in the states and the provinces claiming this employment generation already.
Replying to a query on disinvestment of Air India, the vice chairman further said, the government is committed to turn around Air India and run it professionally. Speaking on the fate of the rupee, Kumar said there was no need to worry about its values as it is still overvalued in terms of real effective exchange rate. Panjaran Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi has said that the proposed grand opposition is merely a grand race by his rivals to be the Prime Minister and is driven by personal survival and power politics. In an interview to Swaraj magazine, the Prime Minister said that the opposition has no agenda and hatred for Prime Minister is their sole gluing force. Taking a swipe at the Congress, Prime Minister said that the main opposition party is fighting a battle for its survival. He also hit out at the previous Congress-led UPA for its dismal management of the economy. He said the economy was in doldrums under an economist Prime Minister and a know-it-all finance minister. He also accused the UPA of leaving the economy in a shape much worse than he had imagined and said some of the budget figures were suspicious. Asked why his government didn't bring a white paper on the state of the economy after taking over in 2014, Prime Minister Modi said that the details about the decay in the Indian economy have the potential to cause a crisis of reputation. And after the Islamic State on Monday claimed responsibility for a suicide bombing in eastern Afghanistan that killed at least 19 people, mostly Sikhs and Hindus, members of the Sikh community staged a protest in New Delhi on Tuesday. Sikhs gathered in front of the Afghan embassy in New Delhi to protest against the militant attack. They were requesting the Afghanistan government to provide security to the Afghani Sikh community. The blast, hours after President of Afghanistan Ashraf Ghani had opened a hospital in Jalalabad, it damaged shops and buildings around Mukhabirat Square in the city. Meanwhile, United Nations Chief Antonio Guterres has strongly condemned the suicide attack in Afghanistan. The UN chief said in a statement issued by his spokesperson that any attack targeting civilians is unjustifiable and in clear violation of international law. He has expressed his condolences to the families of the victims and urged all parties to uphold their obligations to protect civilians, including minority communities. And for more on this, we'll go across to Mr. Sushant Sareen, Strategic Affairs Analyst. Sir, thank you so much for speaking to Rajya Sabha Television. Sir, first, under Taliban rule, the minority Sikhs and Hindus were told to identify themselves by tying yellow bands. Now, then there was systematically, they were driven out of the country to enforce discrimination. And now this attack by the Islamic State. Why Hindus and Sikhs are being systematically targeted in Afghanistan?
Well, I think they're being systematically targeted simply because the radical Islamist organizations anywhere in the world have been, this is their calling as far as non-Muslims are concerned. They have a very simple principle as far as non-Muslims are concerned, that if they wish to remain unmolested, then they either have to pay a jizya tax or they have to convert or they have to leave. So now this is the stark choice which was offered even by the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria. We know the kind of treatment they meted out to the minority Yazidis. We know what they did with the Christians out there, the way they beheaded them, the way they forcibly converted people, the way they kept sex slaves. That is all before us. Even in Pakistan, the same groups, much of the Islamic State in Afghanistan are basically Pakistani Taliban. Who have now broken ranks with the Taliban and joined the Islamic State. And while they were very effective in Pakistan, in the tribal belt, that is the kind of treatment or that is the kind of warnings and threats they had issued to the Sikh community out there. I think we have to remember that the Sikhs in the Pashtun belt of both Afghanistan and Pakistan are original inhabitants. They are not somebody who has gone out there as a migrant. They are sons of the soil. They have been out there for generations. They are, that is their original place. So for these people to now throw them out is something what we have come to expect from radical organizations. So that is what is happening.
And among those killed in Afghanistan was Avtar Singh Khalsa, who had planned to stand in October's parliamentary elections in Afghanistan. One seat in Afghanistan parliament is reserved for a member of a minority community, a small community there. So how politically relevant are the people, Sikhs and Hindus in Afghanistan? What is the political relevance of these people in Afghanistan?
Well, nowadays, I think the relevance has gone down. There was a time before the civil war started, even subsequently before the Taliban came in, when there was a fairly vibrant Hindu and Sikh community in Afghanistan. While they might not have been politically powerful in terms of representation, they were very powerful in the sense that they controlled trade and industry, they controlled the currency markets, and that gave them a lot of influence in that country. They were also very well educated, so some of these people occupied high positions in government because of their talent. But after the Taliban came in, there was a mass exodus of most of the minorities from Afghanistan, but some of them have stayed back. So obviously their numbers are just too small. But to be fair to the Afghan government, I don't think it is part of the Afghan government's turning a blind eye or anything like that. that these people are being affected. I think the Afghan government or the Afghan state as it is currently constituted is along fairly modern lines, and they give reasonable kind of treatment to the minorities. There is absolutely no reason to quibble with them. Now, to demand that the Afghan government ensure the security of the minorities, I think that's a very tall ask of the Afghan government, simply because the Afghan government is finding it difficult to protect anybody in Afghanistan right now because of the activities of the Taliban and the Islamic State terrorists out
Absolutely.
There. So clearly they are up against a wall, and the minorities are suffering the depredations of these people.
And if you talk about India, what are the repercussions from India? Because the people from Afghanistan, what we are getting to understand is they want to come back to India. Will this mount pressure on the Indian government, considering the fact that already we are reeling under the refugee crisis?
Look, I think we need to be very careful about what we are saying. To say that they want to come back to India, there is no question of their coming back to India. They were never Indians. They are not Indian citizens. They share a common faith. They share a common Indic faith, if I might add, with many Indians. And to that extent, if they feel that this is one country which will offer them refuge, I think there is a case to be made for them. Because unlike many other non-Indic faiths, there are other countries which are always ready to offer them refuge. So, for instance, the Christians in Pakistan very often seek refuge in Western countries, in Australia or some of the other countries. They don't come to India. But where do the Sikhs go? The Sikhs have to come to India if they have to go anywhere outside their homeland. And their homeland is Afghanistan. Now, for the government of India, there needs to be some kind of a policy to provide succor to people of Indic faiths who are in the region. They are not economic refugees. These are people who are fleeing religious persecution. And to that extent, if India opens its doors for these people, Hindus, Sikhs, maybe the Buddhists also, I don't think there's any problem with that, because there is nobody else who is going to give them refuge. But India cannot claim a right over these people. But India can certainly open its doors for these people. And these are not, their numbers are not so large that it will create some kind of a refugee crisis in India. I don't think that's a problem. So yes, certainly if they seek refuge, I don't think we should offer unsolicited refuge. But if they seek refuge, I don't see why the government of India should close its doors to them.
Absolutely. Absolutely, Mr. Sareen. Thank you so much for giving a wider perspective on that development from Afghanistan, where the Islamic State has now claimed the responsibility for a suicide bombing in eastern Afghanistan that has killed at least 19 people, mostly in which Sikhs and Hindus have been targeted. Moving on to some other developments, taking strong exception against mob lynchings, including those by the cow vigilantes, the Supreme Court on Tuesday said that the onus lay on the states to ensure such incidents don't recur. During the hearing, the bench observed that the instances of vigilantism was actually mob violence, which is a crime. The Supreme Court added that this was a law and order issue, and each state is responsible to ensure that these incidents do not occur. During the hearing, senior advocate Indra Jaisingh said that lynching by cow vigilantes were happening despite the top court's orders directing the states to appoint nodal officers in each district. On September 6 last year, the Apex Court had asked all the states to take stern measures to stop violence in the name of cow protection. On to some more news. The Supreme Court on Tuesday pulled up West Bengal Election Commission for a large number of uncontested seats in the Gram Panchayat elections held in May. The Apex Court asked the Election Commission to provide exact figures about the number of no contest seats by Wednesday. Supreme Court said that a large number of uncontested suggests that Chapter 9 of the Constitution on grassroots level democracy is not working. The Election Commission is expected to compute the data on no contest seats and file an affidavit in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has ordered all states and union territories not to appoint any police officer as acting Director General of Police. The Apex Court directed all states to send names of the senior police officers to the Union Public Service Commission for being considered as probable candidates for the post of DGPs or police commissioners. The list is to be sent to the UPSC 3 months before the incumbent retires. The UPSC will shortlist three most suitable candidates and states will be free to appoint one out of them as police chief. A bench headed by Chief Justice Deepak Mishra also said that endeavour should be made that the person who is being selected and appointed as DGP has reasonable period of service left. The directions came on a plea of the centre seeking modification of the judgment rendered in the Prakash Singh case on police reforms. And after more than two decades, as many as 32,876 people belonging to the Brew community will be repatriated from Tripura to Mizoram. The Home Ministry said on Tuesday that this is happening following a tripartite agreement signed by the two state governments and the centre. The pact was also signed by the Mizoram Brew Displaced People's Forum in the presence of Home Minister Rajnath Singh, Tripura Chief Minister Biplab Deb and Mizoram Chief Minister Lal Thanhavla. The displaced people belonging to 5,407 families currently living in temporary camps in Tripura will be repatriated to Mizoram before 30th September 2018. And with that, time for a very short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us. Welcome back. You are watching News Tonight. Three pilgrims, including two from Andhra Pradesh, died on Tuesday en route to the Holy Cave Shrine of Amarnath in South Kashmir Himalayas due to various causes. With these, the death toll in this year's Yatra has gone up to six, including three pilgrims, one BSF officer, one palanquin carrier and one Yatra volunteer. Meanwhile, as many as 18,467 pilgrims paid obeisance at the cave shrine. So far, 54,833 Yatris have paid obeisance at the Amarnath Grave Shrine. The Yatra, which began on 28th of June, was hampered for the first few days because of the bad weather. And 308 Indian pilgrims were evacuated from Simikot region in Nepal on Tuesday as the rescue work intensified to bring back over 1,500 Indians who have been stranded in Nepal's mountainous region while returning from Kailash Mansarovar pilgrimage in Tibet. The pilgrims have been stranded after heavy rains caused landslips along the route of the Yatra. The mission, in liaison with local airport authorities and flight operators, operated seven commercial flights to evacuate the pilgrims. Meanwhile, the Indian Embassy informed that two pilgrims each from Kerala and Andhra Pradesh died due to high altitude sickness in Simikot and heart attack in Tibet respectively. Over 1,000 pilgrims are stranded in Simikot and Hilsa in Nepal and another 500 near Tibet site. And incessant rains led to the collapse of an overbridge at a railway station in Andheri suburb on Tuesday morning. At least five people were injured in the mishap. Two of them are reported to be critical. Train services on the Western line were disrupted for some time, causing inconvenience to commuters. Although a major disaster was averted, as a packed train that was to pass Andheri station stopped a few meters from the collapsed bridge. Motorman Chandrasekhar Sawant acted swiftly in stopping the train when he saw a portion of the bridge collapsing. Meanwhile, Railway Minister Piyush Goyal visited the site at Andheri station. Expressing regret, he ordered an inquiry into the incident. He also said that railways will conduct safety audit of 445 bridges in suburban Mumbai.
It's a very unfortunate incident. Most unexpected, and I have ordered the Commissioner of Rail Safety, CRS, which is an independent body, to immediately carry out investigations and inquiry into this fall of the road overbridge and give us a report within 15 days. 6 mahine ke andar, jo Mumbai suburban mein 445 रोड ओवर ब्रिजेस फुट ओवर ब्रिजेस और बाकी जो पाइपलाइन के ऊपर भी जो इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर है क्रॉस करता है रेलवे ट्रैक्स को इसका पूरा जॉइंट सेफ्टी ऑडिट रेलवेज और बीएमसी आईआईटी के नेतृत्व में इसको पूरी तरीके से सेफ्टी ऑडिट करे.
And heavy rains lashed several parts of the country on Tuesday. In Himachal Pradesh, heavy downpour lashed most parts of the state, with Shimla recording the highest rainfall in a day in the last 68 years. According to the Met Department, Shimla witnessed 118.6 millimeters rains during the last 24 hours. The weatherman also issued a 24-hour heavy rain alert for a number of places in Uttarakhand, especially those located in Kumaon region. Heavy rainfall alert has also been issued in at least 5 southern Odisha districts during the next 48 hours. Although in national capital Delhi, it was a sultry day with the humidity levels shooting up to 100%, the maximum temperature was recorded at 36.7 degrees Celsius, while the minimum temperature settled at 23.6 degrees Celsius. On to some more news. Hours after former Union Minister P. Chidambaram was granted protection from any coercive action, the CBI has pressed for his custodial interrogation in the INX media corruption case. The probe agency has alleged that it was necessary as he has remained evasive and non-cooperative during questioning. The probe agency made the submission in an affidavit filed before Justice A.K. Pathak, who listed the matter for hearing on August 1st and extended till then the interim protection against arrest granted to Chidambaram on 31st of May. The High Court, while granting him interim protection from arrest, had asked the senior Congress leader to join questioning and cooperate in the investigation as and when called by the CBI. In Chidambaram's anticipatory bail plea, it was contended that the former minister was being harassed in the case in which he was not named. The senior leader's role had come under the scanner of investigating agencies in the ASL Maxus deal of 3,500 crore rupees and INX media case involving 305 crore rupees. Congress leader Shashi Tharoor today moved a Delhi court seeking anticipatory bail in the case related to the death of his wife Sunanda Pushkar. Tharoor has already been summoned as an accused in the case. The politician's plea was filed before Special Judge Arvind Kumar, who sought Delhi police's response and kept it for hearing tomorrow. In his plea filed through advocate Vikas Pahwa, Tharoor said the charge sheet has been filed without arrest and the SIT has categorically stated that investigation has been concluded and no custodial interrogation is required. Tharoor was earlier summoned as an accused by a magisterial court for the alleged offences of abetment and suicide and committing cruelty towards Pushkar. Senior Congress OBC leader and four-time lawmaker Kunwarji Bavlia on Tuesday resigned from the party and joined as cabinet minister the Vijay Rupani-led BJP government in Gujarat. Bavlia, who accused Congress President Rahul Gandhi of playing casteist politics in the party, was administered the oath of office by Governor O.P. Kohli. And intensified rescue efforts continue today outside a flooded cave in Thailand, where 12 boys and their soccer coach were found alive after 10 days of being trapped. Food supply and medicine was shuttled to the trapped members of the Thai football team, as experts said it could take weeks or even months before they are rescued. The team, comprising of boys aged 11 to 16, and their 25-year-old coach is trapped in a waterlogged cave in North Thailand's Chiang Rai province after heavy rains blocked the cave's main entrance. More than 1,000 Thai military personnel are at the site, as well as teams from 7 countries, including the UK, US and Australia. The boys were discovered on Monday night by British divers 400 metres from where they had believed to be stranded several kilometres inside the cave.
The one thing that they are doing, obviously, is getting supplies into the children so that if the weather closes in, which it might well do, of course, because it's the beginning of the monsoon season, that they are able to sit it out in the where they are. So that will mean bringing in supplies. I think they've talked about getting 4 months' supplies in. So that would be quite an operation, just ferrying that amount of stuff into them.
And India's first adherent multi-wavelength space observatory captured an image of a special galaxy cluster that is 800 million light years away from the Earth. The galaxy cluster is formed of three separate clusters that are all merging with one another to form a single massive cluster in the future. The three merging clusters contain more than 500 galaxies, and the cluster is almost 100 times larger and more than 1500 times voluminous as our own galaxy. However, the cluster contains galaxies spread over a large area. Astronomers zoomed in on six of these galaxies to capture ultraviolet images. Meanwhile, ISRO says the merger is exceptionally well studied, where the galaxy cluster has produced a rich diversity of structures that have been imaged in radio wavelengths by every radio telescope in the world. And that's all we have for you in this edition of News Tonight. For more news and updates, keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.